Jay, you used a phrase I want you to spell out for us, because I think a lot of people have an intuition about this, but they might not know the details. And that's the phrase school to sterilization pipeline.
Yes.
Tell people the different steps along that
I will.
Track.
Yeah, and it's supposedly it's based on what was called the Dutch protocol, based upon a particular Dutch study of, I think it started with about 70 kids, 70 subjects. It ended up with 55 that completed it, in which here's the basic treatment. So you start with social transition. So in other words, you know, a boy that says she's a girl, you sort of call her the boy by girl pronouns, you use a girl's name. Of the school does this, so you're dealing with a psychosocial intervention, right, on the identity of the child. And then if the child's young enough, they could, that can move to puberty blockers, so you sort of freeze them in place temporarily, supposedly, where they are in development. And then that moves on, if they continue down the pipeline, to cross-sex hormones, so testosterone for girls and estrogen for boys. And then that moves on, you know, say from 16 to 18, to actual surgery, in which you have major body parts removed, things like uteruses and breasts and penises, and then facsimiles crafted then a little after. And so you see that you're progressively moving towards sterilization. Now, literally, you sterilize, of course, when you remove a girl's ovaries or a boy's testes, you have sterilized them. You can castrate too, if you've cut off the boy's penis. But that process starts earlier. So if you put a child on puberty blocking hormones, the point of that is to prevent them from developing secondary sex characteristics. And then you put a girl on huge doses of testosterone, her ovaries and her uterus are going to atrophy. And you can actually sterilize a girl just in that way, even if you didn't pass on to surgery. And so you don't, we call it a pipeline because we know, if you look at the numbers before this mania for transitioning kicked in, the vast majority of kids who had prepubescent gender dysphoria, if allowed to go through puberty, think of puberty as the cure for most kids, reconcile with their biological sex. But we now know if you put kids on the transition pipeline, even just the social transition, they are much, much more likely to continue all the way to surgery. And so you might think, well, I'm just changing pronouns and names, it's no big deal. You have set them on a fast track to sterilization. And so it's, you know, I mean, it's not an inapt or unfair metaphor. Now, there will be permanent effects in terms of facial structure and things like that. That stuff kicks in and, you know, the jaw, the voice, vocal cords get longer. And so the voice gets lower. That's permanent.
Yeah. So at the beginning of the pipeline is the school. So there are people at the school. Who are those people who are putting the kids into this pipeline?
It can be absolutely everyone. So it's certainly counselors. It's the teachers in particular. And so very often you'll have, especially if they're young ones. So if you're dealing with a 60-year-old teacher, they went to education school before any of this stuff was in fashion. I hate to say it, but if you have a 24-year-old teacher that went to an education school, he or she has almost certainly been trained in this stuff. And even if it's not in the curriculum, that doesn't tell you anything, because a lot of stuff that teachers use, they get from the internet, they get from teacher training seminars. There are a lot of organizations training teachers now in the materials of gender ideology. And so teachers will introduce that. You might find out, you might look at the textbook and not even know it's there. And so it can be absolutely anything. But the reality is, it's at this point in most places kind of worked its way through the curriculum. And so it appears, it's not just a unit in health class or something like that. It can appear throughout the curriculum. And then if a child, you know, gives some indication that he or she might, I don't know, be gender atypical even, can be very often sent to the counselor, who will, is kind of self-diagnose. And a lot of this stuff, I mean, weirdly, you can, a school can start social transitioning, not based on a diagnosis from a doctor, but based upon the expressed wish of the child. So the school changes its language patterns to refer to the child based upon the testimony of the child. And in some states where the law isn't worked out properly, can do this behind the parents, of the backs of the parents, not by accident, but by policy.
Yes. And so, and then there's also the role of the the GSA clubs.
Oh, absolutely.
What
yeah.
is, now, what does GSA stand
well,
for?
And so they were Gay Straight Alliance. They right. tend to, they're changing the acronyms. And so, because that's not really relevant, right? So they're called Gay Straight Alliance when the question had to do with same-sex marriage and homosexuality. We have moved beyond that now because right. all the stuff about gender, I mean, as you know, in fact, there's a kind of contradiction in the LGBTQ coalition, because if you identify as lesbian or gay, if you're a woman who identifies as lesbian, what you're saying is that you are sexually attracted to other women, right? So you're presupposing the sexual binary. You're That's saying right. there's this thing called women, right, out there in the right. world.
If you enjoyed this clip from the Dr. J Show, you're going to love the full episode. You can get it free on Locals, which is the new home of the Dr. J Show. Unlike YouTube, Locals does not censor content they disagree with. So that's why we're over there. We can keep bringing you the truth about the lies of the sexual revolution and the importance of active, engaged parents in their kids' lives. Click on the link in the show notes below to be taken directly to our Locals page. Become a member and join our community. I can't wait to see you over there.